Recently, a critical Sudo vulnerability was published, and when I saw the reports about it, I thought it could be a great candidate for a series of finding, analyzing, and eventually exploiting this vulnerability. The series will probably have over 10 episodes because I will go into maybe too much detail, but hey, I think this kind of learning resource doesn't really exist. So let's start with part one, the discovery of the bug. Sudo is the utility that you can use as a regular user to execute commands as root. But your user must be part of the Sudo group, and other users on the system, of course, shouldn't be able to use Sudo. And the vulnerability in Sudo means an unprivileged user can now exploit the Sudo program and become root after all. In the big summary video, I already explained that the researchers who found this issue did it through code review. But I want to try to forget about that. I want to forget about most of the information that was shared because I want to use the Sudo vulnerability to learn. And I do this by pretending to do the original research. We can try to make up our own story about how this bug was found. We can create discovery fiction around it. I think that's one of the best methods to learn for me. This method means we don't go in full blind. We know the goal, we know there is a bug, and we have the public information as a cheat sheet. So it's a bit like a CTF challenge where you have write-ups available, but we deliberately limit ourselves. We ignore these resources as much as we can, so we walk this path of learning ourselves. And when it gets frustrating or we get stuck, we can always peek at the solution. That's what I did, and that's what I want to share with you in this series. I encourage you to follow along. I made my steps available on GitHub. You can find most of the important files and resources there. I also try to make individual episode folders so you can track the progress through the series and more easily follow along. So let's get started. The first thing we need is, of course, a vulnerable system that can be used to do the research on. I first tried to set up an Ubuntu VM, but the Sudo version already seemed patched, so I decided to do everything in a Docker container instead. If you want to support this series more directly, I would appreciate you check out liveoverflow.com/support and consider my Patreon or YouTube membership. The button for that is right below this video. The base Docker file that describes our test system is pretty simple. I selected a current Ubuntu version, installed important packages like the GCC compiler, and then downloaded a vulnerable Sudo version from the official Sudo website. Then just follow the install instructions, unpack it, compile it, and install it. I also created an unprivileged user named user, so we have a user we can later use to attack Sudo. To ease our work with this setup, I created a makefile. Typing make all or executing the individual commands make build and make run will execute the Docker commands to build the container with the vulnerable Sudo version and runs it. This will take a bit, and also the Sudo website seems to be down sometime, then you can't download Sudo. For those worst cases, I also copied the archive into the GitHub repository for you. Anyway, once the container is running, confirmed with Docker PS or Sudo Docker PS, you can then use make attach to get a shell as a user, or make root to get a root shell in the container. Just to make sure everything works, you can try sudo edit -s with the payload to confirm that we have indeed a vulnerable version. Okay, now we can start for real. Try to forget everything we have done now. Forget that this is about sudo. Imagine we have a fresh system in front of us and we want to do some security research. This means we need to start somewhere and pick a target so we can start somewhere. There are, of course, a lot of possibilities. So let's hear from the actual researchers from Qualys how they picked their target.
In our team, we used to audit open security softwares, and especially the juicy one, as I said, which means the ones that are almost everywhere. As you said earlier, Sudo is like a tool that is on most Linux systems. Almost every Linux system. So it's an interesting target because of these reasons. And it has some slight differences with the other set user ID binaries in the way that its source code is quite big, which means that the more you write code, the bigger tends to be the attack surface. And finally, it changes a lot compared to other set UID binaries. Which means that the probability to introduce a new bug during each modification exists.
This sounds great. Sudo is open source, It is widely used in most Unix systems, it has a large code base, and it is actively developed. Code is changing all the time. You know how in physics nobody can break the laws of thermodynamics? We kind of have the same in computer science. The more code you write, the more likely it is to introduce a security-relevant bug. And because it's a fundamental law of computer science, it doesn't matter how crazy good a developer you are. Eventually, the code you write will contain a vulnerability. So, to summarize, Sudo seems to be a scary big piece of software, but also a great target to look for some local privilege escalation vulnerabilities. Sudo is our target. Now, let's quickly peek at our goal again. We want to find this proof of concept crash. It looks simple, but how could we find it? Well, there are different creative ways to researching a target and find bugs, but one of the typical strategies is fuzzing. Quite some time ago, I heard about the fuzzing project from Hanno Berg. Here it says, a modern Linux system ships a large number of basic tools that do some kind of file displaying and parsing, and we have powerful tools these days that allow us to find and analyze these bugs, notably the fuzzing tool American Fuzzy Lob and the address sanitizer features of GCC and Clang. And so the fuzzing project aimed to educate people how to fuzz Linux programs to improve the overall system security. So how come that there are projects like this where you would think somebody must have thrown a basic fuzzer at every important Linux program, yet Sudo has such an apparently simple bug? That was a curious question for me, so I decided to try to find the bug with fuzzing with American Fuzzy Lob AFL. I have used AFL a few times before, but generally I'm a complete novice and don't know anything else about fuzzing besides AFL, except maybe writing my own shitty fuzzing Python script. But so my weapon of choice is going to be AFL. You can find tons of easy tutorials for the basic installation and setup of AFL. Here's, for example, the official install document, and it's pretty basic. You just clone the repository and then you build it with make and install the binaries with make install. I've already added this to the Docker file, so when you build the episode 1 container, you will have AFL installed. Now, we need to instrument sudo with AFL. As you can see in the make file, the Docker containers are launched with the current working directory mounted to pwd inside the container. So whatever you do with files in the current directory, you will have them inside Docker. To instrument sudo, we can now download sudo into this folder. This will take a bit, but eventually you can open the code in an IDE of your choice. Then inside of the container, you can find the same files in /pwd. And to build sudo inside the container, simply execute configure, which configures some build stuff, and then execute make to actually compile sudo. But now let's look at the quick start guide txt from AFL. In there, you can find some common ways how to instrument the target. By the way, I'm using original AFL here for now, but later in the series, I will switch over to AFL++. Just wanted to mention that before people spam in the comments. Anyway. As you can see here, AFL wants us to modify those build steps we just saw for sudo. We are running configure again, but we also set the environment variable cc, which overrides which C compiler is configured for the build. Instead of plain GCC to compile sudo, we want to use AFL GCC. This special version of GCC will modify sudo so that it can be fuzzed with AFL. So let's try that. As you can see, the various AFL binaries are installed, and we can now go into the sudo directory and run configure, but specify our AFL GCC. This takes a moment, and you can see here that it uses AFL GCC as a compiler. And once configure is done, we can also do make clean in case we did a previous build and we want to start fresh. And then we trigger a new build with make. If you see a lot of these AFL outputs in the compile log, then you know it's working. However, we are not done yet. The quick start guide says, if the program reads from stdin, run AFL fuzz, like so. If the program takes input from a file, you can put add in the program's command line. AFL will put an auto-generated file name in there for you. This is not quite what we want. AFL was designed to fuzz programs that read from the standard input or read a file, but we want to fuzz the arguments of sudo. That's not a huge problem, but it requires a bit of engineering modifications. Though I also did a quick Google search because I figured somebody else must have done that before. And you can quickly find the experimental argv fuzzing inline header file. Let's see. It says here, this file shows a simple way to fuzz command line parameters with stock AFL fuzz. To use, add this include to the file containing main, ideally placing it right after all the standard includes. Next, put AFL init argv near the very beginning of main. And that's what I did. I copied the argv fuzz inline header into the sudo source folder and then searched for sudo's main, which I found in sudo.c. We can then add the include at the top and add AFL init argv at the start of main. So what does this header file do? Keep in mind that by default, AFL fuzz wants to send stuff to the standard input of a program. So our goal is to somehow convert input data to arguments used by sudo. And AFL init argv is a macro that basically is replaced with this code. And as you can see, it calls AFL init argv function and this overwrites argv. Argv is the array of strings passed into main that contains the arguments. So whatever this function does, it changes where argv points to. And this function now calls read. So it reads from standard input a lot of data. PTR is a pointer into the buffer where we read the data into. Then we have a loop. We check that the byte we are pointing to is not zero, and then we increment and move the pointer forward in a loop. This outer loop also has an RC counter that starts at 1 and keeps incrementing. And at the start, we always remember the current pointer location in the red array. And then there is this inner loop, which also checks for null bytes and keeps incrementing. So basically, we remember this first pointer at the start in this array at location 1, and then we keep reading more bytes, and once we encounter a null byte or a space, we break out, move forward, do it again, and when it finds a second null byte, we are in the outer loop again and write the new location into the next red array element. So basically, it expects an input with a lot of data separated by null bytes, and it creates an array of pointers pointing to those strings. Basically, it creates a fake argv structure from input we read, and it returns that pointer to that structure. So now any code in main after this that uses argv will use the fake data instead of the real arguments. And this is a very important trick for AFL. To summarize, AFL wants to send input to a program, but our target program doesn't read data from input. We want to fuzz arguments. So we add a little bit of code at the start of main that reads data from the input and transforms it into a fake argument structure. Now AFL can just throw data at the input of our modified sudo. Our setup code will create fake arguments from that, and the code that continues to run after that takes our fake values as if you called sudo with those arguments. At least in theory, and this will go wrong, so let's try and compile and test it. Don't forget to configure using AFL GCC, then make clean and make to build sudo. All right, now we would be able to fuzz sudo with AFL like any other program. But first we need to create a test case input folder and an output findings folder, as well as create at least one input test case. I thought a simple sudo minus L might be okay for now. AFL fuzz minus E input folder minus O output folder, and then the sudo binary. Let's go. Oh, whoops, the target binary crashed suddenly before receiving any input from the fuzzer. Program abort, fork server crashed with signal 11. And it turns out when I try to run sudo on its own, I also get a seg fault. This is not good. We can quickly investigate with GDB, run it in the debugger, and we see it crashes in __afl setup first. This is very weird. It crashed in code that AFL injected into sudo for the fuzzing stuff. So I have no clue how to fix that. Well, I thought this would be super simple. I just throw AFL at sudo and we find the bug, but it seems like we are in for a longer ride. The video is getting quite long already, so let's investigate this next episode. Just FYI, my videos take a lot of preparation, which means I actually solved the problem already. So no worries, you don't need to help me in the comments. But you can find the container and additional resources on GitHub. So why don't you try to fix the issue yourself, and then you can maybe fuzz sudo already. Maybe you can rediscover the bug yourself. And with the upcoming video, you can then compare my next steps with what you did. I think this is a great way to practice this stuff and learn more about it. So do your homework and see you next video. Also, maybe check out the affiliate link in the description again for Linode or liveoverflow.com/support. Thanks.